Good morning. Welcome, everybody, to St. John's, this third Sunday of Lent. Good to see you all. Welcome to any visitors that are here with us. We're glad that you're here to listen to God's Word and to sing His praises with us here at St. John's. Our order of service is for you on the screen. If you'd like to follow along in the hymnal, that will begin on 151 with a few changes because of the Lenten season, excluding the Alleluias, most importantly. At this time, you are welcome to greet one another and share the peace of our Lord. Please stand. We begin today in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray together.
O God, whose glory it is always to have mercy, be gracious to all who have gone astray from your ways, and bring them again with penitent hearts and steadfast faith to embrace and hold fast the unchangeable truth of your word. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. We continue with readings from Holy Scripture. The Old Testament reading for the third Sunday in Lent is from Exodus chapter 20. And God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in the earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquities of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not take the name of the Lord God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male servant or your female servant, or your livestock, or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the seventh day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his male servant or his female servant, or his ox, or his donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our epistle is from 1 Corinthians chapter 1. The word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks seek wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews, and folly to Gentiles, but to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God, and the wisdom of God.
For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For consider your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God. He is the source of your life in Christ Jesus, whom God made our wisdom and our righteousness and sanctification and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let the one who boasts boast in the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. At this time, I welcome the children, or at this time, we have the reading of the Holy Gospel. If you are able, please stand. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the second chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found those who were selling oxen and sheep and pigeons, and the money changers sitting there. And making a whip of cords, he drove them all out of the temple with the sheep and oxen. And he poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. And he told those who sold the pigeons, take these things away. Do not make my Father's house a house of trade. His disciples remembered that it was written, zeal for your house will consume me. So the Jews said to him, what sign do you show us for doing these things? Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. The Jews then said, it has taken 46 years to build this temple, and will you raise it up in 3 days? But he was speaking about the temple of his body. When therefore he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoke. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you.
Please be seated. At this time, I welcome the children to come forward for a children's lesson. For those remaining in the pew, this is an opportunity to fill out one of the cards that are in front of you. There's a place on the back of that card for prayer requests, as well as our statement concerning the Lord's Supper that we celebrate today. Excuse me. Good morning. Good morning, how you doing? Good. Okay, can I have you all sit right here? So, because I'm going to show you a story. I'm going to read you a story. Come on over here so you can see the pictures. Can everybody see that? All right. This is a story about God's house, all right? All right. Jesus liked to go to God's house. He liked to talk to God there. He liked to be with God's people. But Jesus did not like what some men were doing. They were not talking with God. They were not talking with God's people. These men sold animals in God's house. These men liked to cheat, and they liked to steal too. You are not doing what you should do in God's house, Jesus said. You must get out. Jesus made these men get out of God's house. God's house is not a place to cheat and to steal, said Jesus. We should go to God's house to be with him. We should talk to God in his house. We should talk with God's people, too. You know, some people talk about a church as being God's house, right? And what should we be doing in God's house? What are some of the things that we do in God's house? We read, we listen to somebody read, and we do reading ourselves, right? One of the things we do is talk to God, and the word for that is prayer, right? Can you say that with me? Prayer. That's right. We pray to God. We talk with God. But we also get to hear God speak. Because this is God's house, we get to hear about Jesus. We get to hear Jesus' words for us, his words of forgiveness, his words of love for each and every one of you. And so that's what we do in God's house. We come to pray to God and to talk to him, as well as to listen to him. Can you fold your hands and pray with me, everyone? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing us to God's house.
Thank you for bringing
that we might talk with you,
and listen to your gracious words,
through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank you so much for coming up today. As they return to their seats, we will continue with our next hymn. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The text for our sermon this morning is our epistle reading from 1 Corinthians 1. We'll be looking at the whole reading, section by section, so that together we may gain a deeper understanding of what God is saying to us through the Apostle Paul. I think we all can agree that nobody likes to be called dumb, right? Nobody likes to be called dumb. Yeah, sure, there are people out there who sort of play up the fact or play dumb, right? They sort of make a joke out of it. Comedians do this all the time. One of my favorite comedians, a guy by the name of Jim Gaffigan, he always plays dumb in his comedic routines. It's hilarious. But I'm pretty sure it's all an act. And of course, there are characters on TV sitcoms and shows that embrace being dumb, right? You have your Homer Simpsons, right? You have, for you Friends fans, you know, Joey Tribbiani, right? And for you Golden Girl fans, you have, of course, Rose, right? Played by the late, great Betty White. People who play dumb on TV provide for some great entertainment. But in real life, in the real world, nobody likes to be called dumb.
Nobody likes to be seen as dumb, as uninformed, as not too bright, especially when it has to do with something important. The Apostle Paul in our reading this morning isn't exactly calling the Christian Corinthians dumb, per se, but he is making a point about the limits of their wisdom and the limits of human wisdom in general. Human wisdom is well and good in its proper place. You can accomplish a whole lot of great things in this world with human wisdom. Just look at where we are today as human beings. We've amassed large amounts of knowledge and technological ability. It's impressive, no doubt. A great blessing in many cases. Not in all cases, but in many cases. But when it comes to knowing and understanding God, knowing what God is up to in this world, knowing what God's will towards us in Jesus Christ, well, human wisdom can only get you so far. In fact, human wisdom can sometimes have the opposite effect, point us in the opposite direction, away from God, towards ourselves. This is what Paul is getting at the start of our reading. A large part of being a Christian is recognizing the limits of our human wisdom. And this begins by embracing what Paul calls the folly of the cross. The folly of the cross. Let's take a look again at what Paul says. For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Now, the word folly can be translated in different ways as foolishness or silliness or absurdity. The point is that by human estimates, according to human wisdom, the message of the cross, the message that the Savior of the world would take on human flesh and be crucified, hung on a tree to die, just doesn't make any sense. That sin and the brokenness of this world would be dealt with in this way, that God's salvation would be displayed in this way, to human wisdom seems absurd. This is not what human wisdom would expect, not in a million years. And yet this is exactly what God has done. The power of God's salvation, his gracious will towards us, has been demonstrated and is only demonstrated in the cross of Jesus Christ, a crucified and suffering Savior. For those who are perishing, the cross will never make sense. But for those who are being saved, it is the power of God's salvation. Because of this, Paul goes on to say that human wisdom with regard to God has been shown to be powerless, thwarted by Jesus and his crucifixion. Paul writes, "For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart." Here Paul is quoting from Isaiah 28:14. However, this prophecy from Isaiah can be found throughout all of the scriptures in many other places. You see, in Christ, God has not only fulfilled his promise of salvation given long ago, but he has fulfilled this promise to do it in such a way that no human discernment, no human wisdom will be able to recognize it. Again, a crucified Savior is not something that we on our own as human beings can comprehend. God has shown that when it comes to him, human wisdom is ineffectual, unsuccessful, or to put it another way, when it comes to God's salvation, human wisdom, as wondrous as it is, hits a brick wall. And so in this reading, Paul continues in this theme, asking a number of rhetorical questions. Where is the one who is wise, Paul asks. Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. Paul assumes that you, the listener, and the readers of his day will know the answer to these rhetorical questions. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the one who on his own, apart from Jesus and his cross, has figured out God? The answer, he doesn't exist. What about the scribe or the debater of this age? Have they been able, through their knowledge and through their eloquence, to figure out God and his salvation? The answer, no. God has shown the wisdom of this world to be foolishness when it comes to his salvation. He has shown the limit of our human wisdom. He saves through the message of the folly of the cross, the proclamation of forgiveness and salvation found in Christ crucified for us and for all. Now, this brings up an interesting question for us. If human wisdom has been unable to truly know God, if human wisdom is fundamentally incapable of wrapping its mind around his salvation, then how is it that anyone comes to know it or to believe in it? Well, Paul says that the knowledge and the faith comes through the preaching of the cross. But we may ask further, okay, then how does the preaching of the cross come to make sense to someone, come to be something that they hold on to as good news? If it's not our wisdom, then what? Well, Paul doesn't give us the answer here. But in other places in his letters and in the whole of Scriptures, the answer is clearly given. People come to the knowledge of salvation in Christ and his cross by the power of God himself, by the power of the Spirit of God. This is what Martin Luther talks about when he explains the third article of the Apostles' Creed. We confess in the Creed that we believe in the Holy Spirit, but as Luther asks us, what does this mean? Well, it means that I cannot, by my own reason or strength, believe in Jesus Christ my Lord or come to him. But the Holy Spirit has called me by the gospel, enlightened me with his gifts, sanctified and kept me in the true faith. Here Luther is simply laying out what all of Scripture say about how a person comes to faith in Jesus Christ and his cross. That on our own, following our own wisdom and the wisdom of the world, we could never figure it out. On our own thinking, human beings are incapable of knowing God rightly as he has revealed himself through the cross. But through the proclamation of the gospel, the folly of the cross, God, by the power of his Spirit, opens our hearts and our minds, enlightens us, shines a light on us and in us so that we might see differently, know differently, so that we might know Christ and his death for us and for our salvation. This is actually pure gospel for us, pure good news. Because if we think that we can figure God out on our own, if it's up to us to climb the ladder of knowledge to understand and gain God's salvation for ourselves, then there's always a couple problems that happen that we run into. First, there's the tendency to sort of pat ourselves on the back, right? To think of ourselves as self-righteous, to think of God's salvation as something that can be earned by us and our learning and our knowledge. In this case, the love of God ceases to be grace, becomes something that we gain for ourselves, something that we can boast in ourselves. This is where Paul will lead us by the end of this reading today. But the other problem, and perhaps the most more likely problem, is that if we think that our job is to gain ourselves God's salvation through our smarts, we begin to despair as to whether we can actually attain it or not. If salvation depends upon our learning, then there's always the question, well, are we smart enough, wise enough, do we know enough? We are left hanging our own salvation on our own abilities and not God's. However, if it is God and God alone who brings us to faith, who brings us into the knowledge of his Son and his cross that we could not find ourselves, if it is God's work and not ours, then we can know for certain, you can know for certain, that it has been accomplished. Paul then goes on to speak of worldly wisdom and how it can actually blind a person to knowing God and his salvation. In verse 22, Paul says, "For Jews demand signs and Greeks seek wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to the Jews and folly to the Gentiles. But to those who are called both Jews and Greek, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men." So in this section, Paul gives us not only a view as to how human wisdom can blind a person from the cross of Christ, but it gives us some insight into the context of the Christians to whom he is speaking. The Corinthian Christians were made up of both Jews and Greeks, and Paul's painting with a broad brush here, but what he says is generally true. The Jews demanded to see signs with their own eyes. We see this in our gospel reading today, where they ask Jesus by what sign he has the authority to do these things. They trusted their own ability to observe and draw conclusions about whether something was from God or not. The Greeks, on the other hand, sought after knowledge. Particularly, they sought the knowledge of God through philosophical inquiry and contemplation and testing claims using their reason. In either case, their ultimate commitment to these avenues of knowing, whether it was seeing with their own eyes or using their senses and reason, it made the cross a stumbling block to them, something that they couldn't get over, something that they couldn't grasp, something that didn't make sense. They were searching for a God that could fit within their system of knowledge. But that's not how God chose to make himself and his ultimate will known. Again, it's not as though using reason or your senses are a bad thing. Far from it. But if your reason and your senses are the only thing you trust, the cross of Christ will be a stumbling block, unintelligible, foolishness, folly. But as Paul says, for those who are called by the power of God's Spirit, whether Jew or Greek, the preaching of the cross has become for them the power and the wisdom of God. Again, this is good news for you and for me and for all, for God has brought us into this knowledge and understanding. Even the foolishness of God is wiser than our wisdom. Even this weakness of God is stronger than our strength. Next, Paul brings it home for the Corinthian Christians. In verse 26, he says, "For consider your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God has chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong." Again, he is not calling the Corinthian Christians dumb, per se. He's not trying to insult his audience. But he is making a point so that they can recognize a couple of things. First, that many of them were not considered wise, powerful, or noble by worldly standards. The people that made up the Corinthian church, a vast majority of them, were not the bigwigs in society. They were not the elite in society. The other thing that Paul wants them to understand is that God chose them to know the salvation in Christ so that God might shame those who consider themselves wise and powerful and noble in the eyes of the world. Now, we don't know how the Corinthian Christians took this message, but I imagine they would take it in a very similar way that we would take it if we think of Paul speaking to us. Again, nobody likes to be called dumb or weak for that matter. But when it comes to the knowledge of God and his salvation, this is very close to what we are. We are spiritually weak. Left to ourselves, we don't have the smarts or the powers to understand God or gain his salvation. In Christ, God accomplished something that goes way beyond our human wisdom and even subverts our human wisdom. And yet it is this work that is the gospel for us and for all people, the very power of God unto salvation for us and for all who believe it. Finally, Paul brings our reading to its conclusion. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing the things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God. And because of him, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us the wisdom from God, righteousness and sanctification and redemption, so that as it is written, let the one who boasts boast in the Lord. It is here that Paul points the Corinthian Christians and us to the main point of it all. That it is God's work and God's work alone that has brought us into the knowledge of Christ, that has united us to him in faith. Jesus Christ crucified for us, the folly of the cross is the true wisdom of God on display. It is our righteousness, it is our sanctification or holiness, it is our redemption. It is faith that grasps these things and holds fast to them. It is faith itself, a gift from God that unites us to Christ and his suffering and his death and brings us into his new kingdom, into a new life, even to life everlasting. Because of this, we are unable to boast in ourselves. We can only boast in God, and it is right to do so. For he has worked his powerful salvation for us through the preaching of the folly of the cross of Jesus Christ. Folly to the world. Incomprehensible to human wisdom, absurd to those who are perishing, but for you, the very power of God unto salvation. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. At this time, we join together to confess the Nicene Creed. If you are able, please stand. I believe in one God, the
Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank you all for your generosity in giving to the work of the church. It is through your giving that the church is able to do what it does, both here and abroad. There are offering depositories, offering something at the entrances. There's also an opportunity for online giving if you would find that more convenient. We continue with our offertory, Let the Vineyards Be Fruitful. We continue with the prayers of the church, remembering those who have requested our prayers listed in our bulletin. Please join with me. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. O Lord, you are a jealous God. Save the third and fourth generations that will come after us from your punishment. Fill us with your Son's zeal for your house, that we may cast every idol from our hearts and be devoted to you and your commandments. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
O Lord, your Son's cross and crucifixion is folly to the world, but it is the source of repentance and forgiveness for all his elect. Preserve the preaching of the cross in our midst, that from this life-giving tree we would continually receive your faith-preserving gifts. Be also with our missionaries who proclaim this word, this folly in all parts of the world. Be with those who work at Mission Central, and also be with the Bobby family serving in Riga, Latvia. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
O Lord, preserve and bless all Christian households, that husbands and wives would live in love and service to each other, that fathers and mothers would diligently bring up their children in your fear, and that children would honor their parents and be well equipped for service to their neighbor in this life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord of perfect law, you have called us to honor our parents and all other authorities, that it may go well with us in our land. Bless Joseph, Christy and Larry, John, Mike and Dustin, and all who govern and represent us. Make them wise in your ways, that your justice may be upheld among us. Help us to serve and obey them in accordance with your will. Bless and protect all soldiers, especially those serving overseas, including Matthew Bobby. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord our God, your steadfast love in Christ is good. Turn in your abundance mercy toward all who suffer in our midst, including those who suffer from cancer, including Gerald and Jean, Lindy and Emily, David and Dennis and Stan, Pam and Arliss, Bob, Christy, Jolene, Forrest, Marvin, and Linda, as well as those who are hospitalized or dealing with health issues at home, including Stan and Jeff, Frank, Jerry, Diane, as well as Pax. Do not let the flood sweep over them, nor the pit close its mouth on them. Deliver them and grant them healing, comfort, and peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, our rock and redeemer, though we cannot even discern all our errors, declare us innocent in Christ of all hidden faults, and by your Holy Spirit, keep us back from presumptuous sin. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, you bless this day and make it holy with your word and the gifts of your altar. Grant that we may come before your presence to eat your Son's body and blood, not boasting of ourselves, but of Christ alone. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, our rock and redeemer, 3 days after the temple of your Son's body was killed by wicked men, he raised it up again. We ask that you would be with those who mourn, including Jan, Weiss, as well as the Diekman family, as they mourn Dwayne's loss. Grant that on the last day, we and all the saints who now rest in your presence may share in the glory of his resurrection. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We continue with the service of the sacrament. If you are able, please stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who overcame the assaults of the devil and gave his life as a ransom for many, that with cleansed hearts we might be prepared joyfully to celebrate the Paschal feast in sincerity and truth. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, and trusting his promise, we are bold to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Once
One brief note before we have the words of institution. If you would like to receive the common cup, feel free to go ahead and cross your arms so that we know who is receiving it in that manner. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, after supper, he took the cup, and giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the remission of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
stand to sing the Nunc Dimittis. Let us pray. O God, the Father, the fountain and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in the sacrament. And we ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Please be seated. We conclude with our final hymn. Spring day? That seems like it. Just a few announcements to be made. Josh, do you want to go first?
I guess you go.
Okay, I'll go first. We have our Lenten midweeks at Wednesdays at 10 a.m. and 7 p.m. We continue with our focus on Exodus and the theme, Let My People Go. The Living Last Supper, there are rehearsals as well as a choir rehearsal for that. That is on Tuesdays in March at 7 p.m. There is an Easter breakfast sign-up. So we have Easter breakfast in between services on Easter Sunday. There's a sign-up sheet. I believe there was an email sent out, but there's a sign-up sheet in the gathering area out there as well. April 6th is the day we're going to Mission Central. If you have not been, it's an experience, as so is Gary Teese. You don't meet Gary, you experience Gary. He is a great person. Mission Central has done so much to raise a majority of the money that goes to our missionaries. They're a clearinghouse for millions and millions of dollars in missionary help. And Gary Teese has done this out in Mapleton, Iowa. So we're heading out, departure at 8:30, sign-up sheet on Josh's door. And finally, the applications for preschool are available for the next coming school year. So if you're interested in that, please sign up with that. Go in peace and serve the Lord. I'll leave it to Josh.
All right. Thank you, Pastor Bobby. Just a couple of additional announcements. Please be aware that, just to put this on your radar, that March 30th at 11 o'clock is the Easter egg hunt. Again, that's March 30th at 11 o'clock. That's the children's Easter egg hunt for St. John, so just be aware of that. But we're also going to need help assembling those Easter eggs. We have quite a few more Easter eggs this year, so that's going to be on Tuesday, March 26th at 5:30. So if you can just start putting that on your calendar if you're willing. Again, the 26th at 5:30 for the assembly, and then March 30th at 11 for the children's Easter egg hunt. And again, please, if you're interested in going to Mission Central, please sign up before the end of, March, before Easter, so I can let Mission Central know who's coming. God's blessings, everyone. Thank you.